honored to have Shaykh Abdallah. He came an incredible distance at his age. It's obviously more difficult. It's difficult enough for a young person. So alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shaykh Abdallah has really spent the last several years in an attempt to renew usul al-fiqh and the centrality and importance of usul. Imam al-Qushayri mentions that every aspect of the scholars has a function in Islam. And he said the function of the usuliyun is the quwwat, that they're the generals. The usuliyun are the people that have a strategic vision that often people of lesser understanding cannot see, because they look at what's called the ma'alat, nadhar lil ma'alat. They look at what will come from actions. We know in the Native American tradition, the Iroquois, they used to look at seven generations. When they would do something, they would see how it would affect seven generations. And this is traditionally the role of the mushtahidun, is to think about what are the consequences of the actions. And so this is really his role. But he's also, because of a lot of the wars that have arisen recently in the Muslim world, the collapse of some states and the conflicts, he has focused almost entirely on promoting peace in the Muslim lands and globally. And this led to the creation of a forum, the Forum for Peace, that he started this initiative, and had a conference in Abu Dhabi where he brought some of the top scholars from all over the world to really say in solidarity that we need to work for peace in our community. His argument is that peace, people say no peace without justice. He thinks that that statement is a very dangerous statement, because there's never full justice in this world. There will always be injustices. It's the nature of the abode. And therefore, we need to work for justice within peace. And that this is extremely important for us, because he feels that in peace, wrongs can be redressed in ways that they cannot be redressed in war, because war engenders more wrongs very often. So the topic about this tonight is fiqh al-waqa', and the Shaykh has written on this subject and the importance of scholars recognizing the conditions. And so inshallah we're going to look at this. There's technical aspects to this talk, because it's really more of an academic subject, but because of a lot of the confusion, the widespread confusion in the Muslim Ummah, we thought that it was important that this topic be addressed in terms of how we look at these things. أولاً أنت أخيراً كتبت الكتاب تنبيه المراجع وهذا عن فقه الواقع تأصيل فقه الواقع فممكن تحدثنا عن ما مدلول هذا الشيء ومعناه وأبعده.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، اللهم صل وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم ألهمنا رشدنا وعنا. فقه الواقع هو جواب على من يطبق فقها في واقع ماض على زمان حاضر. السؤال عن فقه الواقع هو سؤال يستبطن أو يشير إلى مشكلة، هذه المشكلة هي هذا الواقع الذي نعيش فيه وهذه الفتاوى التحريضية أحياناً وهذه المشاهد البشعة وهذه الأعمال الفظيعة هل تعتمد على فقه أو أنها تعتمد على نصوص مجتزأة وفروع بلا قواعد وجزئيات بلا مقاصد.
So the question is about the concept of fiqh al-waqi', which would be really about the jurisprudence of reality, of how we're looking at reality and how we understand reality in order to arrive at judgments and what the fuqaha are doing. And he said that really the fiqh al-waqi', this fiqh of reality, is about the looking at the tradition of the past, but also looking at the circumstances of the present. And it's really indicative of the problems that we witness in the current reality. Because very often we have, for instance, legal opinions, the responsa of the jurist, which are called fatawa, the fatwas, that very often these are fatwas that engender, they become sources of agitation in a society, and sometimes they lead to things that we witness in the world, very disturbing scenarios arise out of these. And we see also actions that are completely, really deeply troubling and disturbing. And the question is there a basis for these things? What are they relying on? Are they relying on a legal tradition, or are they really an example of looking at the branches without roots, without understanding the roots? Are they example really of a type of legalism that ignores the spirit of the law, so it becomes the letter of the law without any sense of what the spirit of the law is? Are they looking at particulars without understanding the universals?
أولاً أريد أن أعتذر للجمهور لأن السؤال هو في موضوع متخصص جداً، هو في صناعة، والصناعة عادة إنما يحسنها أهلها، قد يستفيد منها الناس، لكن الصانع الذي يتقن هذه الصناعة لا يمكن أن يتحدث إلا بلغة الصناعة. ولهذا أعتذر للجمهور إذا استعملت جملا أو استعملت ألفاظا لا يدركون مغزاها ولا يعرفون مرماها، فهذا من ضرورة العلم، أي من ضرورة الصرامة العلمية والصدق في العلم.
So first of all, I want to apologize to this large group that's here, because I'm going to have to speak in a language, because these issues deal really with a craft. This is really an intellectual industry that has very specific technical vocabulary that means very specific things within that craft. And like any craft, if you take a craftsman, the craftsman knows his craft. We might benefit from the craft, but we don't understand how he actually did that. And so when we look at these things, we have to understand that this is also a craft. The faqih has a craft, and he's a skilled intellectual craftsman that is producing something, and the technical terminology and training necessary to produce that thing is understood within the artisans, the intellectual artisans of that craft.
لهذا سأحاول أن أختصر إلى حد ما المسافة لأقول أولا إن الإشكال الذي طرحناه هو ما هو الواقع.
So I'm going to try to really to abridge or really to lessen the distance here by being very abridged in my remarks. But the first is, how do we understand the waqa, which is the realities that we find ourselves in?
المسألة الثانية هي ما هو تأثير هذا الواقع على الأحكام الشرعية.
And then the second question is, what is the effect of these circumstances that we find ourselves in on legal categories and legal rulings that would be that would concern those realities?
المسألة الثالثة ما هي ما هو الخلل الذي نشأ عن عدم اعتبار الواقع.
And then the third question is, what are those problematics? What are those the sources that are problematic that arise out of an ignorance of those realities?
فبالنسبة للواقع، الواقع هو عبارة عن ما نشاهد.
So the reality is simply what we see around us.
طبعاً بعض الفلاسفة قال لا يوجد واقع.
So some philosophers have argued that there, it doesn't really exist.
الذين ينكرون وجود الأشياء لسبتيك. هم عبارة عن المشككين في وجود الأشياء.
So there are philosophers that are called skeptics that say that reality really can't be known.
ولكن لعلنا نعقول مع البعض الآخر وأحسبه ربما كانت هو أن الواقع واضح جدا بحيث أنه لا يمكن تفسيره لوضوحه.
So there's other philosophers, perhaps Kant among them, that say that there is a reality, but we can't really be certain about it, or we can't understand it with any true clarity.
أبو حامد الغزالي تكلم عن الواقع من خلال أربعة وجودات: وجود في الأذهان، ووجود في اللسان، ووجود القلم، وجود في البنان، ووجود خارجي وهو الوجود الحقيقي ما يسمى بوجود العيان. فتكلم عن الواقع من خلال الوجودات، أي الشيء ما يكون موجودا في ذهنك، ما يكون موجودا في الكتابة أو في اللسان، أو يكون الوجود الحقيقي هو وجود العيان، أي ما نسميه بالوجود الخارجي.
So Imam al-Ghazali identified four types of four degrees of existence. There's an existence which is a mental existence, that what exists in our mind, how we conceptualize things. And then there's also the what we articulate, and then also what we write, so discursive writing and where the oral becomes the written, and it can be transmitted and go beyond generations. And then the fourth one is wujud al-khariji, which is the existential existence that each one of us experiences that has a real existence outside of us.
الوجود الخارجي هو الوجود الحقيقي.
This is the external existence is what we call real existence.
لأن قد نتصور بعض الأشياء التي لا وجود لها.
So humans can imagine things that have no existence.
وبالتالي إذا تحركنا من خلال هذا التصور قد نخطئ خطأ كبيرا.
But if we act according to what we imagine, then very often our actions are misguided.
تلك إحدى المشاكل التي نعيشها.
This is one of the major problems that we're living today.
نفترض وجودا، نفترض واقعا، قد يكون واقعا مضى افترضه في الزمن الحاضر.
We have a conceptualization of the world that might be a historical conceptualization that no longer exists, but it exists in our mind, and so we act in the world as if that historical conceptualization is still present, but it's not.
واقع العالم الحاضر ما هو؟ هو واقع السفينة. كل الناس في سفينة واحدة.
So what is
يتحدث عنها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
What is our reality? Our reality is like the hadith in which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم likened it to a ship in which all of humanity is on.
من لا يدرك هذا الواقع فإنه يخطئ.
So the one that doesn't understand that reality, he's going to make mistakes.
ما يظن أنه سيعمل نظاما وفي أبراج عاجية أو أبراج قملية دون هذا العالم فسيكون مخطئا.
So he's going from his mistaken understanding, he's going to build ivory towers or castles out of sand, and he's completely misguided.
واقع العالم هو واقع الجسد الواحد.
He said the reality of the world is the reality of one body.
إذا بير نفط توقفت في مكان ما في الخليج العربي يؤثر على البورصات في نيويورك.
If you have barrels of oil that disappear in one part of the world, it affects people in other parts of the world.
هذا الواقع مؤثر في الأحكام.
So this reality has an impact on Islamic categorizations and legal rulings.
ويؤثر في التكاليف البشرية خطاب التكليف.
And it also has an impact on the human responsibilities that we have from God.
فقد جاء في الحديث الذي يرويه الترمذي وكذلك الطبراني عن نعيم بن حماد عن أبي الزناد عن الأعرج عن أبي هريرة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إنكم في زماني. الزمان هو الواقع. إنكم في زماني من ترك منكم ربع عشرة ما أمر به هلك، ثم يأتي زمان من عمل فيه عشرة بعشر ما أمر به نجا.
There's a hadith that the Prophet ﷺ is reported to have said that's related by Imam al-Tirmidhi and Tabarani and others from Nu'aym ibn Hammad, that the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever leaves one-tenth of what you have been given from this teaching in this time, they will perish. But whoever leaves later, there's coming a time when whoever fulfills only one-tenth of what's been given to them, he or she will have success. They'll have salvation.
إن هذا الحديث يدل على تأثير الزمان في التكاليف الشرعية.
So that hadith is a clear indication of the effect that a time that you live in actually impacts the responsibilities and the expectations that God has of you.
طبعا أهل الحديث أريد أن أقول لهم كلمة. الحديث بالنسبة لي هو حسن بمتابعاته وبشواهده.
So I want to say, if there's any people from the people of hadith in the audience, this hadith, as far as I'm concerned, it's a good hadith. It's Hassan, and it has other testimonies from other hadith that indicate that it has a good sound, good Hassan.
لأنه تابعه أحمد في المسند أيضا.
Imam Ahmad followed it in his Musnad.
عن مؤمل إلى آخر السند.
From مؤمر.
مؤمل.
مؤمل.
عن مؤمل.
Yeah, مؤمل. So he related from another source and followed it from that.
إنكار النسائي له فهو أمر لا يعتمد على شيء كبير. هو كأنه المتن استهول أن الإنسان كيف يعمل فقط بعشر ومع ذلك ينجو. فإنكار النسائي له يخالف قواعد النسائي، لأن النسائي يأخذ عن من اختلف فيه كنعيم بن حماد، والنسائي يخرج ما لم يؤتلف على اطراحه،
So Imam al-Nasa'i, he disagreed with the hadith, but in disagreeing with it, he went against his own principles in because he accepted Nu'aym as a source. So he said he was disagreeing more with the metan and what it said than actually with the senad, because he couldn't understand how somebody could only do 1/10 of the religion and still have salvation.
Nu'aym ibn Hamad rawahu an Sufyan bin Uyaynata wa Sufyan an Abi Zinad wa an al-A'raj wa an Abi Hurairah wa huwa sanadun sahihun kulluhu.
So this riwayah that comes from Nu'aym, that if you look at the rijal in it, they're sound.
An Sufyan.
Sufyan. An al-A'raj.
Bin Uyayna. An Abi Zinad. An al-A'raj. هذا طبعا خرجت بكم شوية.
He said, I went out a little bit, but one of the things that I think is useful... so he just wants to let you know that, because there are some critics sometimes that might know a little bit about hadith and or have studied some things, and then they want to criticize. He's just letting them know, I know these problems, and I know the men in these things, and I know what the ulama have said about them, and this is my conclusion. And he said, I could go on with other proofs to show you this, but suffice. The point of all of this is that with the changes of times, the changes of rulings also occur.
وقد يتغير المفهوم أيضا.
Even the understanding or the interpretation could change.
Concept.
The concept.
قد يتغير المفهوم بتغير الزمن.
So the concept could actually change with the changing of the time.
ولأجل هذا لا بد من طرح الأسئلة وهي أسئلة ما هو ماذا لماذا كيف متى أين.
ما هو لماذا؟
هاو هاو إيش عندكم بالإنجليزي؟
نعم.
هاو وات
ما هو لماذا وات
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 وين
ما هو لماذا؟
لماذا تغني ماذا؟
ماذا ما هو ماذا
لماذا؟
نعم.
لماذا كيف؟
كيف نعم. So there are certain questions, obviously, are necessary in understanding. So the first one is to understand what is it, mahua, what's the essence of the thing, and then you have to know why is the thing, what's the reason behind it, and then also how, like what's the application.
فمثلا حتى لا أكون تجريديا abstract فلا أتكلم عن الواقع.
So I don't want to be abstractive here, and so I'm going to speak now, because these are abstract concepts, I'm going to take them down to the actual practical. So we're going to take these questions, and we're going to apply them to real situations. For instance, the concept of jihad. What is jihad?
لماذا جihad?
Why jihad?
كيف يكون الجihad?
And then how? What is the applicability? How is it implemented?
أولا الجihad ليس مرادف القتال.
The first thing in the concept of jihad is that it's the meaning of jihad is not limited to fighting. That's not the limitation of the word.
وهذا بكلام الله سبحانه وتعالى ونبيه.
That's based on what the Quran, what Allah said in the Quran, and also what His Prophet said.
فالله سبحانه وتعالى يقول وجاهدهم به جهادا كبيرا أي تلو عليهم القرآن.
So Allah says in the Quran to do jihad with them, a big jihad, and this verse is understood by the commentaries to mean to speak to them about the Quran.
والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول والمجاهد من جاهد نفسه في طاعة الله.
And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in a hadith, the mujahid, the one performing jihad, is the one who struggles against himself for the sake of God.
فالجهاد يطلق على القتال يطلق على كل عمل صالح على القتال لمحافظة على النفس لي تقوم به الدول ولا يقوم به الأفراد. إذن نعرف ما هي حقيقة مفهوم الجهاد.
So jihad can be used for fighting, for defending the self. Nations have a right to defend themselves. Individuals have a right to defend themselves. This is one concept of jihad, but it also is understood to be any good action that one does, the good deeds that one does, struggling against the self.
والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعلمنا تغيير المفاهيم. فهو يقول المهاجر من هجر ما نهى الله عنه. المهاجر كان الذي يذهب إلى المدينة لكن قال لا هجرة بعد الفتح، ثم بعد ذلك أعطى المفهوم الهجرة أعطاه مفهوما آخر.
So the Prophet himself showed us that concepts actually change. So for instance, the concept of hijra, which is the migration that the people made from Mecca to Medina, once the Mecca was opened for the Prophet ﷺ became part of Darul Islam, the Prophet ﷺ said there's no hijra after this, but he talked about the muhajir, the one who migrates is the one who migrates from his bad actions. So he actually took a concept that had a physical meaning for the Sahaba and he gave it a conceptualization now that had a spiritual meaning.
المسلم بعد أن عرف الناس حقيقة الإسلام قال والمسلم من سلم الناس من لسانه ويده.
So the Muslim, which meant initially it meant to enter into Islam, but then the Prophet ﷺ said a Muslim or the true Muslim is the one who people are safe from his hand and his tongue. So he took a concept that had one meaning and then he gave it a new meaning once they understood the first meaning.
المؤمن من أمينه الناس.
And then mu'min, which means to believe in God, the believer in God, the Prophet said the mu'min is the one who people are safe from his harm. So he took a concept, once they understood it, he gave it another conceptualization.
قال للرجل الذي يريد أن يذهب إلى القتال قال له ففيهما فشاهد اذهب إلى والديك.
A young man came to the Prophet ﷺ and asked him, give me permission to fight, I want to go fight. And he said, are your parents alive? And he said, yes. He said, go and do jihad by serving your parents.
هل الأولى أن نعمل جهادا متفقا عليه ومجمعا عليه وهو كل القربات كما يقول ابن تيمية الجهاد هو كل القربات بما فيها التجارة والصناعة والكلام لابن تيمية في اختياراته التي ذكرها البعض أو نذهب إلى جهاد لا أعمى لا يهدف إلى لا ليست له نهاية إلى مصلحة معتبرة شرعا أم أن نعمل الجهاد الصالح بذكر الله سبحانه وتعالى وببر الوالدين وبالخير وبتلاوة القرآن أم نذهب إلى طريق لا نهاية لها لا أفق لها.
So the question then is, do we understand jihad, this understanding of jihad, in this restricted meaning of fighting, or do we understand what our scholars have agreed upon, that it has all these different dimensions? And then even like Ibn Taymiyyah said that it was any of good deeds, like Al-Ba'li relates on him, that it was any good deeds that Muslims did. And it included commerce, if your intention was to help and benefit the society and industry, all of those aspects were considered under the concept of jihad. Or do we go to this blind fighting that has become the call of so many people that we don't know where it's going? It looks like it's just perpetual war that we continue to fight. Do we take this understanding of it and abandon these other understandings of service, dhikr Allah, recitation of Quran, doing good deeds, all of these things? So it becomes only understood in this blind concept that has no apparent objectives in sight.
تقتل فيه الأنفس بلا فائدة.
People, the souls are annihilated without any benefit.
هنا نقول كلمة الإمام أحمد لا تسفكوا دماءكم ودماء المسلمين معكم وَانظُرُوا فِي عَاقِبَةِ أَمْرِكُمْ وَاصْبِرُوا.
I'll say what Imam Ahmed said, don't shed the blood, your blood, and don't shed the blood of Muslims. And look at the consequences of these actions. Rather be patient.
لماذا جهاد؟
So now we ask why jihad.
What's
the understanding? We did the what is jihad? Ma huwa now limada? Why jihad? So why fighting?
هو أذن للذين يقاتلون بأنهم ظلموا وإن الله على ناصرهم لقدير. إذن أذن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بأنهم ظلموا. ما هو هذا الظلم؟ الذين أخرجوا من ديارهم بغير حق إلا أن يقولوا ربنا الله. هو منع الحرية الدينية. وهذا الجهاد إنما تقوم به دولة. الخطاب هو لدولة المدينة وليس للأفراد. ننظر إلى الشروط التي وضعها العلماء.
So just looking at this, going to why jihad, why fighting? It's clear in the 22nd surah of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that permission was granted, udhina, permission, so it's idhin, it's a permission. Why? Because they are being fought themselves and oppressed, and they're being driven out of their homes. Why? Only because they say our Lord is God. And so he said that this is the beginning of the permission was to protect religious freedom. But this khitab, and this is, in other words, the actual who is being spoken to, because in the Quran there are different khitab, there's different audiences of the verses. The audience of this verse is the government. It's not individuals. It's actually the government. In other words, it's the polity that defends the people, because this is the role governments have been instituted among people to defend security. That's one of the primary purposes of government. And so the verse is being directed to the people, ulul amri, to the people in charge, not to individuals. It's to prevent aggression against people. And then it's in a world where there's no covenants, there's no treaties.
في عالم ليست فيه أسلحة نووية تبيد البشرية.
It was also given in a time when there were not nuclear weapons that could annihilate humanity.
فمن يدعي جهاد طلب في هذه الظروف فإنه مخطئ شرعا وخاطئ.
So those who claim what's called jihad talabi, which is when you're called to defend or fight, those people that are claiming this in these circumstances, he's wrong. He's mistaken. Allah says, those who you have covenants with from among the polytheists.
إذا استنصركم أهل دينكم فانصروهم يقول إلا على قوم بينكم وبينهم ميثاق.
And then it says in the Quran that if you're called to help people from your own religion, but it's against people that you have a covenant with, that you should do it unless you have a covenant with the people. You can't be treacherous with that covenant.
إن ميثاق المواطنة أمر مهم.
So this covenant of citizenship is extremely important to understand what it is.
المواطنة السلم وإن جنحوا للسلم يجنح لها. لا ينهاكم الله عن لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم إن الله يحب المقسطين. هذه آيات محكمة.
So these verses in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if they incline towards peace, incline towards peace also. These are important. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says he does not prohibit you from having relations with people that don't persecute you, that you show them care and concern and share your wealth with them. And these are verses that are still considered, they're not abrogated.
إن الدخول في حروب في الوقت الحاضر هو سبيل إلى الفناء والإسلام لا يريد العبث ولا يريد للناس الفناء.
This call to going to war, this warmongering that exists today, is really an invitation to the annihilation of humanity. And Islam is not a religion of nihilism. It's not a religion, it's not meaninglessness. There's purpose in our religion.
الواقع الآن هو واقع متغير عن واقع الزمن الماضي.
The current circumstances that we find ourselves in are completely different from the circumstances of the pre-modern world.
الواقع الآن فيه إبادة بشرية في الحروب.
The reality of today is that people are annihilated because of wars.
الواقع الآن فيه معاهدات دولية.
We also have an international system of treaties that Islam has always recognized.
لم تكن في الماضي.
This international set of treaties did not exist in the pre-modern world.
الواقع الآن فيه تقوم فيه دول ليس على قوة السلاح وإنما على أساس المعاهدات الدولية. وهذا لم يكن موجودا.
There are many countries that now are very small countries, but they're protected by these international treaties, or else they would be eaten up by stronger countries in this law of the jungle of might makes right. And that did not exist in the past. People could invade small countries and take them over.
في الماضي لم تكن لا توجد حدود في العالم إلا بقوة السلاح.
So in the past, the demarcations of societies, the actual borders and boundaries of societies were determined by war. They weren't determined by treaties.
كيف نفهم الفرق بين الواقع في الماضي وبين الواقع اليوم؟
So this is how we should understand the past, the historical past, and the reality that we're living in today. It's a different world.
ولهذا فعندما نفسر هذا الأمر فليس للحياز وليس لمجاملة وإنما نطلب من شبابنا أن يكونوا عقلاء أن يلتزموا دينهم أن يعرفوا طريق الجنة ولا يذهبوا إلى طريق النار.
So in saying this, I am in no way biased or taking sides in this situation. I'm simply making a statement of reality. And I'm not saying it out of cajoling anyone or flattering anyone. I'm saying this because I want to see our young people thriving and doing things of benefit, and they should be on a path of production and a path of benefit and flourishing instead of a path of destruction and despair.
إذن فعندما عرفنا ماذا ما هو الجهاد عرفنا لماذا الجهاد في أي ظروف يطبق الجهاد أعتبر أننا فهمنا الآن المفهوم الجهاد وأن مفهوم الجهاد ليس مفهوم قتال وإنما هو مفهوم مصلحة ومفهوم حكمة والإسلام يقوم على الحكمة والمصلحة والرحمة و هذه الأمور كما يقول ابن القيم
وعدالة.
والعدالة بارك الله فيك ذكرني أربع دعائم هي المصلحة والحكمة والرحمة والعدل. الإسلام يقوم على هذه. أن تقول أنا أريد أن أقيم العدل عن طريق الحرب أعتقد أن هذا العدل لن يقوم. لا بد أن نسلك مقاربة جديدة فهما جديدا أن نبحث من جديد على طريق يمكن أن توفر الحياة أولا ثم يمكن أن توفر العدالة ثانيا.
So it's important that we remember now we understand hopefully the concept of jihad, what it is, and then why jihad exists, and then how jihad is supposed to be applied.
we should understand that in its essence, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah said that every aspect of Islam involves four. These are the four foundational pillars of the religion. He said it's maslaha, it's benefit, it's hikmah, it's wisdom, it's wise, and prudent in its application. And then it's rahmah, it's mercy in the very center, the heart of Islam, it's mercy. And then it's also just, it's adala. And he said, but those today who say that we need to use war to establish justice, his argument is that this is not the in the conditions that we're in today, this is not the way that we're going to establish justice, that it's better to create a space of peace, an Irenic situation that Muslims can then work towards that justice. And he said that we need new approaches to the past approaches.
هذا الذي نقوله نحن لا نريد أن ننكر أنه يوجد في بعض المناطق من العالم ظلم لكن لا نريد أن يكون الظلم أكبر لا ننكر وجود منكر في بعض البلاد لكن لا نريد أن يكون المنكر أكبر نحن نريد موازنات عقلية تسمح للإنسان بالحياة أولا ثم بعد ذلك تسمح له بالحصول على حقوقه كاملة غير منقوصة.
So I'm in no way denying that the world doesn't have many places where there's injustice. I'm not denying that. There is injustice in the world, and we should be working to remove those injustices. So I'm not in any way saying that. But what I'm saying is that in our approaches to removing these injustices, we should not create greater injustices. We should not create situations that engender more pain and suffering than has already arisen out of the injustices. That we have to actually work towards removing these things in ways that mitigate those injustices, not ways that accentuate those injustices with intelligence and with a type of approach that is balanced and reasonable.
إذن هذا هو تفسير تأثير الواقع في الأحكام الشرعية.
So this is an example, an interpretation of the reality based on these legal categories and judgments that our religion gives us.
طبعا لا أريد أن أدخل معكم في الواقع الواقع والواقع المفترض والواقع المتوقع.
So I'm not going to enter into the actual reality, and then you have a hypothetical reality, which we would call scenarios, and then also what's expected in the future. He said that's a more academic approach that we would
لكن
have.
أريد فقط أن ننبه على أن الواقع المتخيل لا يمكن أن توجده في بيئة عالمية لا تقبله.
So my point is that this imaginary reality in the mind, I mean, it's paradoxical, but this reality that the individual is perceiving in his mind, which doesn't correspond to reality in the world, he said that that it's unacceptable as an approach to try to apply an imaginary reality to another reality.
الجهاد كلمة جميلة. لكن يجب أن لا نستعمل هذه الكلمة في غير موضوعها حتى لا نكون كمن قال الله فيه ومن الناس من يعجبك قوله في الحياة الدنيا ويشهد الله على ما في قلبه وهو أرد الخصام وإذا تولى سعى في الأرض ليفسد فيها ويهلك الحرث والنسل والله لا يحب الفساد
So we don't want to be amongst those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that they, when they speak, they impress you with their words. Their words are impressive. And they swear that they're sincere in what they're saying. But when you see them take authority in the land, they begin to kill and destroy the benefits of the agriculture and other things. And they sow corruption in the land. So they're the opposite of what they're saying.
من يريد أن يكون مجاهدا حقا يطيع الله سبحانه وتعالى ليطيع والديه ليخدم وطنه الذي هو فيه. إذا كنت في كندا فكن خادما لهذا الوطن، كن خادما للتعايش للسلام، هذا هو الجهاد الحقيقي.
So if you want to practice jihad here, then you should have the jihad of taking care of your parents, the jihad of being a good citizen. People that are in this country of Canada, you should be doing things that are beneficial to your society, service and being productive. These are the jihads.
إنه لا يحزننا أن يكون المسلم متهما وكأنه شخص مجنون يفجر هنا وهناك.
So it's deeply distressing when you see the Muslim is a suspect and is suspected of doing all of these mad acts that we see around us.
لا يفرق بين بريء ومجرم وظالم ومظلوم.
They don't distinguish between innocent people, between people.
هذا ليس صحيحا وليس في مرضاة الله ورسوله.
He said this is totally unsound and it's certainly not something that is something that God is pleased with.
علينا أن نعرف الواقع حتى نتصرف طبقا للشريعة في هذا الواقع.
So we have to know the reality and in order for us to act in accordance with our Sharia based on the reality.
علينا أن نقوم بالدعوة لديننا في منافسة شريفة مع كل الأديان.
He said that
الذين والمواطنون الذين هم إخوة لنا في الوطن وفي الإنسانية.
He said that we should have an open-ended invitation to our religion, but in a noble way, that is in noble competition with other religious claims, that this is the right of people to spread their beliefs, but this should be done in a noble way.
الواقع هو الذي ينطبق عليه خطاب الوضعي. خطاب التكليف هو خطاب مرسل. وخطاب الوضع هو خطاب مقيد. طبعا الكلمات هذه أعانك الله عليها هي ليست سهلة.
So there are many types, but there are two specific types in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to us. He speaks to us in responsibility. Sometimes it's a collective responsibility, sometimes an individual responsibility. Sometimes it's specific to rulers, and sometimes it's specific to the people of the population. But then there's also, and this is open, the way it's left in the Sharia, Allah says establish prayer, but that doesn't include children. So they don't have to do it. So there's another khitab, which is the khitab al-wada, which is that khitab that limits and specifies. So you don't have to pray all the time. You pray when dhuhr comes in.
Circumstances.
Yeah, the circumstances. So it's the actual discourse of circumstance. It's the circumstances that make the taklif binding on the individual or collective.
فكل أمر أمر به الشارع أو نهى عنه فله شروط وأسباب وموانع. الشروط والأسباب والموانع هي خطاب الوضع.
So all of those things that Allah has told us to do, they have conditions that they're contingent upon, and then they also have causes that impact them, and then they also have things that actually constrain them, prevent them. So just a quick example, if you have prayer, you have to have the condition of wudu. And then the sabab of the obligation is like when the sun moves onto the thing. And then the mani', what would prevent it, would be, for instance, a woman who has menstruation. That's a mani', so she can't. So this is how our Sharia looks at things. So the khitab al-wada' is what addresses the circumstances of the obligations.
الشريعه هي خطابان، خطاب تكليف وفيه خمسه انواع، خطاب الوضع وهو ثلاثه انواع او عشره انواع بزيادات القرافي.
So the Sharia is, it can be divided into these two discourses from God. The discourse of obligation, تكليف, and that has five t- types, so five or seven, depending on, because contracts and things like that can either be sound or unsound. But you have the five, which are the obligation, the what's recommended, what's permitted, what's makruh, and what's haram. Those are the five. But then, and then seven, if it's sound or unsound. Abu Hamid adds those. And then you go to also the wada, which are three, and then you can add with the majority, which are the conditions, the rationales, the causes that come in, and then the constraints of it, and then Imam Al-Qarafi and
Imam Al-Qarafi taqdirat wal hijaj.
So Al-Amidi, he included azaim and rukhas, which are when you have permission to there's licenses to suspend things because of hardship. And then also there's taqdirat. So there's different types of mashaqqa, for instance, things like that where there's difficulties. He said, let's not drown in the ocean.
Just
stay on the shore.
لهذا أنا أقول لأبنائنا تعلموا الشريعة تعلموا شروط الأوامر والنواهي تعلموا كل ما يحيط بتطبيق الأحكام بدون هذا التعلم تخطئون الطريق.
So what I'm saying to our youth and the children of this abna, the children, the sons of this religion and daughters of this religion, learn your religion, understand it. It needs education. It can't be implemented without education, rightly guided education. Because if you don't learn these things, then you, whatever you do, you might be thinking you're acting in a goodly way, but the reality of it is you're mistaken and you'll end up causing harm.
الواقع الذي نعيشه يقتضي فقها جديدا يقتضي فقها مجددا.
So this reality that we find ourselves in today, it really does need a fiqh that is renewed to address the issues of our time. Just as the fuqaha in the past addressed the issues of their time, we also have conditions, circumstances that demand that we address them. And it also needs the skill that goes in giving legal responses.
ولهذا بدأنا بالعلماء في السنة الماضية لأنهم هم الطبقة التي تفتي للناس.
So this is the reason why we began with an initiative of a group of scholars to begin to train them in the ability to make these fatwas based on sound understanding.
لأن العلماء بإمكانهم أن يفهموا الآليات الميكانيزم الآليات التي من خلالها تطبق الأحكام.
Because the scholars can understand, it's possible for them to obviously to understand the mechanisms that will enable them to give the proper responses to the circumstances they find themselves in.
في أثناء عقدنا لمؤتمر السلام بعض الشباب احتج وقال لا نقاتل الظالم قلت لهم لا تقتلوا أنفسكم إن الله كان بكم رحيما.
So when we were at the forum for promoting peace, some of the youth said, what? So we don't fight against oppressors. And he said, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is don't kill yourselves because Allah was merciful with you. You have to look at the cost benefit. This is the analysis that the Sharia does. What's the wheel, the common wheel, and what is the harm that is derived from a situation? And then you weigh those. When the harm is greater, it's something you don't do. When the benefit's greater, it's something you do. He said, all of our religions and our Sharia is no exception. All of our religions have prohibited dhulm, oppression. And our Lord said in a hadith Qudsi, I have prohibited oppression on myself. I made it haram on myself. God says this. And so I have made it also haram for my servants. So don't oppress one another.
لكن دعونا أن نعرف الطريق الأولى والأمثل لنزيل الظلم أو نزيل بعض الظلم.
But let's look and examine what is the best approach to removing the oppression in our world. What is the most ideal approach in the conditions that we find ourselves to remove this oppression? Let's look at and examine this.
ليس خطابنا تضامنا مع الظالمين ولكنه تضامنا مع الضحايا.
What we're saying right now is in no way in solidarity with oppressors. We're in solidarity with the victims of all of this conflict between oppressors and people trying to remove the oppression.
هناك جملة من المفاهيم الأخرى التي يحكمها الواقع أيضا.
There's another group or category of concepts that determine also how we engage the reality.
دار الإسلام ودار دار الكفر ودار الحرب يعني مصطلحات قديمة عند الفقهاء.
So we had technical terms amongst the jurists in the past. There were parts of the world called دار الإسلام, which is the abode of Islam, Islamdom. And then you had the abode of disbelief and the abode of war.
ما هي الدار الآن؟
What is the abode? How do we describe the دار today?
هي لم تعد تخضع لذلك التقسيم.
That pre-modern categorization no longer fits in the taxonomy of the present.
لأنه كان تصنيفا وليس توقيفا.
Because this was a descriptive understanding of the fuqaha, and it wasn't descriptive.
نعم.
And it wasn't in any way something that was written in stone by God.
فالدار الآن هي العالم أصبح دارا متعدد الثقافات الديانات كل إنسان يمكنه أن يؤدي شعائره فيها بدون قهر وبدون قسوة.
We're living in a world, in most parts of the world now, it's possible, if they're all multicultural, you're in a multicultural society here, it's possible to practice your religion in ways that people couldn't do before. So we're living in a very different world now. The abode has shifted.
فهي دار جديدة. This لها أحكام جديدة.
It's a new abode, and therefore it necessitates new categories and new legal rulings.
أصبح العالم بالمواصلات والاتصالات الجديدة والآليات السياسية والعالمية أصبح في دار واحدة.
So now with all of this mass communication that we have, the wonders of communication, things have changed. We have now political entities and mechanisms that didn't exist in the past.
بقدر ذكائنا وإيجابيتنا يمكن أن يكون لنا مكان في هذه الدار.
To the degree with which we have intelligence and capacity, that we can change our situation.
Efficacy.
نعم.
فعالية efficacy ليس عندكم بالإنجليزي efficacy.
Effectiveness.
Efficacy. بالفرنسي efficacy. معناها شيء فعال فعال.
فعال. Yeah. Capacity. Yeah.
Yeah. سامحوني.
Yeah, effectiveness. That's what I thought. It's effectiveness. Yeah.
الواقع إذا واقع متغير الأحكام الشرعية تتغير بتغير الواقع.
So this is well known amongst the fuqaha that rulings will change based on the changings of the circumstances.
الأمثلة كثيرة.
There are many, many examples of this.
العهد الأول يعني بعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بعشر سنوات أو بأقل حتى بعد سنتين يعني. تغير الواقع تغيرا ربما ليس كبيرا جدا لكن مع ذلك تغيرت كثير من الأحكام.
In that first period of Islam, within the first 10 years, there was already a change, and then the rulings changed.
مسألة الخراج عند عمر.
And also, for instance, the خراج, which is a type of tribute.
على الأرض.
on the land, which is something that is the government will impose on people when new lands come into the Muslims.
وضع الزكاة على الخيل.
Or for instance, zakat on horses.
كما فعل عمر.
Omar did that because the situation changed. There wasn't zakat.
مع أنه في الحديث أن لا زكاة عليها.
But in the hadith, there's no zakat in that.
ران الخيل يعني أصبحت للبيع.
But people were buying and selling horses. They didn't do that in the earlier period. So he saw that it changed.
توقيف العقوبة السارق في المجاعة.
Also, the suspension of the traditional penal code, the suspension of the penal code for theft during the famine. The Sayyidina Omar suspended, his ruling was that it's no longer applicable because of the circumstances in Ramada.
كثير من الأشياء تغيرت بسبب تغير الزمان.
Many things changed because of the change in the times that occurred.
إذن الواقع له تأثير على الأحكام الشرعية.
So the situation has it changes based on.
يمكن أن تقرأوا كتابي في فقه الواقع حتى تجدوا كل الأمثلة والبراهين على ذلك.
So he wrote a book on this subject and gave many many examples in the book. To prove these points.
خرج منذ قريب من سنة ولم يرد عليه أحد من العلماء.
He said it came out a year ago and none of the ulama have been able to refute it up till now.
وصدورنا مفتحة للكلام.
And he said everything I put out is open. If you want to refute it, let me see your refutations.
ذكرنا الواقع في المجال الاقتصادي.
I mentioned the reality in our economic conditions that have changed. He wrote an entire book dealing with derivatives and all of the new commercial problems that are in. And he put this out because he said you can have piety in the skyity economics, but if you're dealing with the real world, the Muslims have to deal with it.
وذكرنا تأثير الواقع في المجال السياسي.
And also, I looked at the political, the realities of the political situation, how they impact.
وأهمية الفرد الآن التي بما يسمى بحقوق الإنسان. نعم. أهمية الفرد.
Individualism.
Importance.
Yeah, individual. And also the importance of what now is today called individualism, that the whole concept of the individual has shifted greatly in the modern world. People were much more social people. What was important was the social group. Now the individual, his importance has overridden the importance of the social group.
والعقد الاجتماعي بين الحكام والمحكومين.
And then also the social mentality has shifted between what was traditionally called the rulers and their subjects. So now you have the concepts of citizenship, which is different from the pre-modern world.
والتقنيات الجديدة التي أثرت في الأحكام الشرعية.
And also all this new technology that has had an impact on legal rulings.
الجينوم البشري والبصمات الوراثية.
We've got now, for instance, fingerprints, DNA testing, all of these new criminal determinations that didn't exist in the past.
إذن الواقع هو أمر مهم جدا. قد يكون بين أيدينا لكننا لا نراه.
So reality is an extremely important matter. Sometimes it's right in front of us and we're unaware of it.
لندرس الواقع حتى يكون بيننا سلام في أنفسنا والسلام مع الآخرين.
So we have to study the situation we find ourselves in to understand it, understand its sociology. And then in order to engender peace and conviviality, these are what we have to do.
حتى يوجد انسجام بين ضميرنا الديني وبين الحياة التي نعيش.
And so we arrive at a type of harmony between our moral conscience, our religious conscience, and the societies we find ourselves in. So there's not a contradiction between.
ديننا يدعو إلى محبة جميع الناس لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه النبوي ابن رجب الحنبلي شبراخية المالكي كلهم يقول أخوه في الإنسانية
So our religion calls to universal love. It does. In the famous hadith, none of you truly believes till he loves for his. It says brother, but it means fellow man. What he loves for himself, and this was the understanding of Imam Nawawi, Imam Ahmad, Imam Shabrakhiti. All of them said this included your human brother. So it's the fraternity of humanity.
لا يوجد إلا الحق أو الباطل. إلا الظلمة أو الضياء كما قال أبو بكر الصديق يا هادي الطريق إنما هو الفجر أو البجر أقول لشبابنا إذا كنتم تريدون كلاما يرضي أهواءكم ونزواتكم اخرجوا على الناس بسيوفكم اقتلوا وتقتلون بلا فائدة أو إذا كنتم تريدون حقا وتريدون صدقا فنرجوكم أن تحكموا العقول وأن تحكموا المصالح وأن تحكموا الحكمة لتحكموا الشرع.
So I'm really saying to the youth that if you want to follow your own whims and desires and go out and kill others and kill yourself, this is one way. He said, but that's not our way. Our way is the way of intelligence. I'm challenging you to use your reason, use your intellect, to think about the benefits and harms and go out. This is the right way, not the other way.
هذا هو الواقع الذي ينبغي أن نتعامل معه. هل أتجاوز عن الواقع لتسأل سؤالا آخر؟
في سؤال يعني حينما الناس يرون الاختلافات بين العلماء لأن القنوات الآن عندك قنوات وعندك عالم في قناة يقول شيئا وعالم في قناة آخر يقول شيء معاكس تماما فأصبح العامة يتحيرون قد يكون يعني مفتي يزعم أن هذا عنده يعني مرض خلل في عقله فلذا أفتى هكذا واحد فيتحير يعني كيف نحن مثلا في إيران عندهم مرجعية كيف المسلمون يفهم ما هي مرجعيتنا في ديننا
ترجم لهم السؤال
يعني I'm asking the question that in the satellite in the world of satellite communications now every Tom, Dick and Abdallah has a station and so people get up and they give fatwa and people watch a fatwa on one channel they turn it down the road and they get a complete opposite fatwa on another channel they hear an opinion one sheikh says oh that sheikh he's got sickness in his mind it creates confusion in average Muslims and for instance, in Iran, the people tend to have a reference point amongst their scholars. So they have a kind of control over their religious discourse. In our Sunni tradition, for those of us that are Sunni, what is the reference point for, and how can common people be removed from this type of confusion?
الجواب أولا هو كما قال علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه عرف الرجال بالحق ولا تعرف الحق بالرجال عرف الحق تعرف من يأتي
So one of the answers comes from Sayyidina Ali who said know men by the truth and don't know the truth by men through men
عرف الحق تعرف من يأتي
So know the truth and you'll know the truth when you see it
الفتوى لها شروط لها شروط في صحة الفتوى ولها شروط في علاقتها بالمفتي.
So the fatwa itself has conditions. It has conditions that determine whether it's sound or unsound, but it also has conditions that relate to the mufti himself.
الفتوى ترجع إلى نصوص شرعية وإلى مقاصد شرعية وإلى واقع.
So the fatwa it has three aspects. It has the nusus themselves, which are where the fatwas are derived from. So the Quran, the Sunnah, the ijma, the qiyas. Those And but then it also, it has the maqasid. In other words, what is the spirit of the law? So it's letter of the law, spirit of the law, looking from both those vantage points and then looking at the reality and how we apply the letter and the spirit onto the reality.
إهمال أي من هذه إهمال النصوص أو إهمال الواقع أو إهمال المقاصد هذا يوقع الفتوى في الخطأ.
So to neglect any one of these three elements, the nusus, which are the actual text, the Quran and the Sunnah, and what's understood from that, and then what is the maqasid, what are the ends, the ends and the meanings and the spirit of those texts. So that's the why. So you have the what and the why, but then you have the how. So those are the three, it goes back to those three. And then how do you apply it to the, if you neglect any one of those three, then you will have a mistake in the fatwa, invariably. If I take the nas only, the text itself, and I apply it literally, I will fall into error. The Khawarij, those rebels that rebelled against during Sayyidina Ali's Khilafah, they used a verse in the Quran to prove their position, which is there's no ruling except the ruling of God.
قالوا لا حكم إلا لله لأنه هو حكم ناسا بينه وبين معاوية لإيقاف الحرب.
Because Imam Ali took a judge, an arbiter between him and between Sayyidina Muawiyah, and that affected to arrive at a resolution. The Khawarij said, no, there's only God's judgment. You can't bring another arbiter. So they used the ayah and applied it literally to the ijtihad of
Sayyidina Ali. قال كلمة حق أريد بها باطل.
Imam Ali said the famous statement, this is the use of a true statement, but it's being used for an untrue purpose.
لماذا؟ لأنهم لم يعرفوا كل النصوص.
And the reason, because they were detextualizing the ayah and didn't see the holistic nature of the religion.
لأن الله حكم بين الزوجين قال ابعثوا حكم من لي وحكم من
لي. In another verse, Allah says, when there's marital discord, it says, bring an arbiter from the woman's family and bring an arbiter from the man's family. But the Khawarij were taking one verse and not seeing that another verse gives you another meaning of it.
فدماء الناس أولى لتحقن الدماء.
Preventing bloodshed is more important than preventing divorce.
فأخذ النصوص المجتزأة يؤدي إلى الخطأ في الفتوى.
So taking these nusus out of context and particularizing them, this always will result in error.
النصوص التي لا تنظر إلى الواقع تؤدي إلى الخطأ أيضا.
So those nusus, those that are applied on circumstances without taking the circumstances into consideration, this also leads to error.
يقول عمر بن عبد العزيز تحدث للناس أقضيتهم بحسب ما أحدثوا من الفجور أي يأتي أحكام شديدة للناس بسبب أحوالهم.
So the caliph said that those things that are needed, the new positions that are needed are based on what people do from their own sinfulness. So as sinfulness increases, the necessity for new opinions increases.
هاي الأحكام بأخذ من مقاصد الشريعة ومن مصلحة واقع معين.
So he took that understanding from this idea of a general common weal.
فالخطأ إذا ينشأ من النصيين إذا صح سميهم من النصيين الحرفيين و الذين لا يراعون المقاصد والخطأ ينشأ أيضا من عدم الاهتمام بالواقع.
So that's another aspect of a mistake, which is the mistake of literalism, and many errors will come out of that. Those people that are literalists, and don't understand the nuances of language, ambiguities, and different applications and interpretations that can come out of language. But then also the third problem is not looking at the circumstances that people find themselves in.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yaqul wa la taqtulu anfusakum inna Allaha kana bikum rahima.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not kill yourselves because Allah is merciful to you.
فَإِذَا قُلْتَ لِشَخْصٍ خُرُوج عَنْ هَذَا النَّصِ فَأَنْتَ حِينَئِذٍ مُخْطِئٍ لِأَنَّكَ تَرَكْتَ مَقْصِدًا عَامًّا وَنَصًّا عَامًّا لِقَضَايَا غَيْرُ مُحَقَّقَةٍ.
So if somebody says to you, don't apply that text, go to another text, he's taking something that is a general and then he's leaving that general for a specific situation or circumstance that is ambiguous or unknown. You don't know what the end result of that will be.
الذي يأخذ جزءا من النصوص دون النصوص الأخرى ودون القواعد هذا يرتكب خطأ كبير.
So those who take particulars without taking into consideration the universals that override those particulars in many instances, then they'll end up making mistakes as well.
فمشكلتنا مع الفتوى ليس أن نمنع الفتوى بل أن نعلم من يفتي ليكون مستوعبا لأبعاد الشريعة.
So the problem is not with fatwa, but the problem is with the levels of education in those giving fatwa. They have to be trained to understand these dimensions, these three dimensions, and take them always into consideration in issuing fatwas.
ولهذا لا بد من تعليم مجموعة من الشباب ومجموعة من النساء حتى تكون لهم أهلية الفتوى.
So this is why it's extremely important that we take some of our youth from the men and the women and train them properly so that they can help people and guide people in these important issues.
لا يمكن في هذا العصر أن نقتصر فقط على بعض العلماء الذين قد يخطئ بعضهم وقد يصيب ككل البشر. لكن علينا أن ننزل علم الفتوى إلى أرض الواقع لأن الناس الآن أصبحوا بسبب المواصلات والاتصالات أصبح كل واحد يتخذ قرارا ويقول أنا ذاهب إلى الجنة مع الأسف الشديد قد لا يكون هذا القرار مصيبا وقد لا يذهب إلى الجنة نسأل الله العفو والعافية.
So we have to be very careful in this age where you have all this telecommunications and people watch things and listen to things and then they take their own opinions about it and then they go off thinking they're on the path of paradise and they're actually not on the path of paradise. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for well-being about these things.
الخلل فيها يكون من جهل الشريعة، الخلل فيها يكون من جهل العلاقة بين القواعد وبين النصوص الجزئية، الخلل فيها يكون أيضا من عدم مراعاة المآلات التي تؤول إليها الفتوى.
So the defects that occur in these fatwas are from those three, and then another aspect is looking at the consequences down the road, because that's another dimension, that's a fourth dimension, the dimension of time. So you have to look down the road at what is going to happen. ممكن كذلك الحرم يعني حرم الفتوى ألف باء جيم.
هو سبق أن وضعنا معيارا. هذا المعيار فيه ألف باء جيم. ألف هو عبارة عن أمور عظيمة لا يفتي فيها إلا المجامع الفقهية وهي قضايا الحروب والسلام وكل ما فيه قتل الأنفس كل ما فيه تضحية بالنفس وباء وهو قضايا دون ذلك القضايا الجديدة الشركات والعابرة القارات والشركات الكبرى وكل القضايا الاقتصادية الجديدة وفتوى جيم وهي فتوى في الأمور العادية كالصلاة والصيام ونحو ذلك. هذه في الوسط يكون لها لجان أي باء، وفتوى جيم يكون كل أحد كل فقيه يعني علم منه الديانة وعلم منه أنه يعرف مذهبا من المذاهب المعتمدة يمكن أن يفتي فيها بمذهبه. إذن هذا كان معيارا وضعناه حتى نقول للناس انظروا فيه قضايا لا يمكن أن يفتي فيها كل أحد، يمكن أن يكون صوته رفيعا، يمكن أن يكتب على الإنترنت، يمكن أن يكون شجاعا، لكن هذا لا يكفي ليقيك من عذاب الله سبحانه وتعالى. فالقضايا الكبرى التي فيها الدماء والأموال والكفر والإيمان، هذه القضايا لا يجوز أن يفتي فيها أفراد، بل لا بد أن تفتي فيها مجامع فقهية وتكون فيها شبه إجماع عند الأمة. أما القضايا الوسطى الجديدة المتشددة الآن كقضايا المشاركات في الشركات والبنوك والتضخم إلى غير ذلك من القضايا الجديدة التي يعرفها أهل المجامع الفقهية يفتي فيها أيضا بعض اللجان. أما القضايا العادية التي لم تتغير ولم تتبدل كأحكام الصلاة وأحكام الصيام والحج ونحو ذلك فيفتي فيها الفقيه الذي عرف بالديانة وعرف أيضا بمعرفة الفقه.
So one of the things that Shaykh Abdallah laid out was a pyramid of fatwa. So fatwa A are the fatwas, the legal determinations that affect nations, affect bloodshed, affect, for instance, apostasy, all those type of...
Kufr al-Iman.
Kufr al-Iman, yeah. The belief and disbelief, that those are not for individuals. Those are actually done because it affects states and it affects things. That's not for individual muftis to do, and it takes collective fatwas under the guidance of state leadership. And he said the B fatwa would be fatwas that involve the complexities of modern life that are new, commercial laws that didn't exist before, the type of banking institutions, fractional reserve banking, the problem of inflation when you owe debt and you have a currency collapse, do you pay the money back? That also takes a higher level of faqih. So those are people that have to be at a high level of fiqh and understanding and preferably working collectively to achieve these, with experts also from those fields, because you need economists to explain things, you need doctors to explain things, organ transplant, things like that. The third type, C fatwa, is a fatwa that involves just everyday things that people have that come up, and that is, if somebody has studied a valid madhab and knows the rules of that madhab, they can answer their questions about children in terms of divorce, where the child goes to, or praying on an airplane, doing wudu over your socks, things like that. All those things can be done by people who have studied the madhab. So, عندنا صلاة العصر والمغرب بعد 30 دقيقة فبعض الناس يخرجون ليصلوا. إن شاء الله نختم.
نختم.
نعم.
مجال الفتوى هو مجال الاجتهاد، وأنواع الاجتهاد ثلاثة كما يقول الشاطبي: اجتهاد في النصوص وهو في ألفاظ النصوص وهو الجواب على ماذا قال ربكم، واجتهاد في المقاصد وهو جواب على لماذا قال ربكم، لأن الشريعة معقولة، ما هي المصلحة التي لها ورد هذا الحكم، واجتهاد في الكيفيات وتطبيق الأحكام والواقع وهو الذي يسمى بتحقيق المناط. هذه الأنواع الثلاثة من الاجتهاد لا بد أن نحصلها، وفي ختام هذه الكلمة نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا جميعا للخير، وأن يهدينا ويلهمنا رشدنا ويعيننا على قول الحق وينصرنا بالحق في مصلحة الإنسانية ومصلحة إخواننا من المسلمين هنا ومصلحة هذه الديار وديار العالم، وأن ينزل الله رحمته على أهل الأرض، وأن يوقف أن تحقن الدماء وترد الحقوق ويقوم ميزان القسط في العالم. هذا هو دعاؤنا، ونسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى لكم جميعا التوفيق. وأقول لأبنائي من الشباب بالذات، نقول لهم إن عليكم أن تتعلموا العلم وأن تقوموا بالعمل الصالح وأن تجددوا الحياة لتكون أمتكم أمة عظيمة أمة رائدة، وأن هذه أمتكم أمة واحدة، وأنا ربكم فاعبدون وأنا ربكم فاتقون. نكون بهذا نكون قد أدينا خدمة لأنفسنا وللبشرية. وهذا الكلام إنما هو من واقع الشفقة عليكم، وليس مجاملة لأحد، وإنما هو الخير والبركة التي نرجوها لأنفسنا ونرجوها لكم جميعا. ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا إننا سمعنا مناديا ينادي الإيمان أن آمنوا بربكم فآمنا. ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. ربنا وآتنا ما وعدتنا على رسلك ولا تخزنا يوم القيامة إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. آمين يا أرحم الراحمين يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغفرك.
So the Sheikh said that the Sheikh said that about fatwa, there's three types of fatwa according to Imam Al-Qarafi, the great Maliki scholar from Egypt. The first one is the Imam Shatibi, great Andalusian scholar. Maliki scholar from Andalusia, he said there was ijtihad in the nusus, which is understanding and deriving meaning from the actual text, and this is the fatwa of mada, of what God says. But then he said the ijtihad in the maqasid, which is the ijtihad in the actual spirit and meaning of those texts, and that's a fatwa on why, limada. And then finally, how you implement the nas and the spirit in the reality, and that's kaif, that's the how, the last component, and that is based on what's called tahqiq al-manat, which is understanding the applicability of a text and the spirit of that text in an actual given situation. And so this is what the mujtahid needs to know and be able to do in order to arrive at sound judgments. And so he concludes, he's just saying that really, he's encouraging you to learn your religion, especially the youth, to understand the depth of this religion, the importance, to go out and do positive things and really restore the glory of this community, because it's a glorious community in what God has given it to do. To be witnesses of truth and virtue and uprightness. So he's saying that this is what we should do. We should really be fulfilling our ummatic responsibility as a community. And he's saying, I'm saying this out of really care and concern for all of you. This is why I'm saying it. And then he made dua, inshallah, for that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this. Jazakumullah khairan.
Barakallahu fiik.